And welcome back to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson's Sorcery. This is an LP where you get to choose the outcome at the end of, well, one of possible choices and contribute to the ongoing storyline. Anyway, when we last left off, we encountered this whirlpool, and then this... was it a kid? A small boy from Shadrack the Hermit. Had a message about the fire serpent. Who is following me is going to attack while I sleep. I'm afraid to go to sleep. And the whirlpool or vortex or whatever the hell it is, he jumped and then he was pulled into the air. I don't know if that was on purpose or not. And the boy hit the whirlpool and vanishes. He cannot hear us. You creep slowly closer to the thing until you are barely a sword's length away. It remains in position, spinning rapidly. From here you can make out little more about it, except that deep inside something flashes. So, last episode... basically unanimous. That I should reach inside and see what it is. Could be the thing that I found a key for. What was the key? Let me just refresh my memory. We found it inside a snake. Snake belly key. We may or may not find what that holds. Or it could be money. It could be something. And we only have 7 out of 17 stamina. I am anticipating we will lose some of it reaching inside, but you guys wanted it. Here we go. You reach out a hand above the top of the whirlwind. The force it exerts downwards is quite strange. Then suddenly, without warning, it gets stronger. The sound coming from the thing increases in pitch dramatically. Step back, wait to see what happens, or cast a spell. You look to the heavens, hoping to cast a spell. When you try to pull your hand back to begin casting, you find you cannot move it. It is too strongly held in place above the whirlwind. The force on your hand is getting significantly stronger. I was going to cast the How spell, which is safest escape or psychic info, that kind of thing. I get my list of spells on hand for the next time. Well, I'm going to continue following you guys' wishes. Since you're not here to tell me again, I don't want to put up a 3-minute episode, so I'm going to wait to see what happens. You wait to see what will happen. A moment later, the force has tugged your arm down inside the whirlwind. From there, you cannot save yourself. You are trapped inside, and whatever happens there is so quick that you lose consciousness before you understand it. What's my fate? You have been trapped inside a deadly whirlwind. Your adventure is at an end. Gee, thanks, guys. I didn't even lose any stamina, but somehow I'm dead. Can I rewind without being dead? Oh, yeah. For the sound, I'm just going to do everything the same here around the rock. Whirlwind. I don't remember what I did. Did I approach it? Step back. Look up. How do you know who I am? What message? When will this happen? Look out! The whirlwind kicks a short distance up into the air as if leaping, then settles back down again. A reaction to your voice or merely a chance movement? Well, now I can cast something. I must have chose something different than last time. Find safe passage. You wind the stars into order around you, and find a quiet voice enters your mind. It tells you that the whirlwind is a rare thing, a place with only one direction. It can be entered, but it cannot be exited, and is best avoided. Then the voice fades. Okay, we're going to move on then. You move away from the whirling air. Whatever it is, based on what happened to the boy, it is probably best left unexplored. The path leads in two directions from here. One new clue and another has been updated. So, the boy, I guess, didn't mean to do that? Or is he like a spirit of the air or something? Who the hell knows? Clues. The fire serpent is following you, waiting for a chance to attack. Well, this will be a good time because I only have 6 stamina, I'd say. I wonder what was updated. That's the water serpent. Silver weapons. Yeah, nothing new here. For sleeping of the sleepless ram, seek the one they call the sham. Oh. Is it Shadrack? Well, he's a shad, not a sham. Hoping we find some food or something. I mean, I do have 1 blimberry juice. I think that only gives me a point or 2. So that's all I have. Let's investigate this. You make your way over the rocks and boulders, following the trail where you can, and scrambling the rest of the way. Darkness closes in. You need to rest. You pause to rest near a large rock spire that sticks from the dirt like a claw through cloth. It looks like there's a way in. Look at the rock. The rock is a single shattered spire, perhaps once part of the shadowy mountain range to the east, or perhaps driven up through the ground by some geological quirk. At the base of the rock is the mouth of a cave. If I look inside the cave, let me look around the plain. All around, dusty plains stretch north and west. To the east, the mountains are cutting out the stars. Look inside the cave. You approach the cave with one hand on your blade, remembering the giants in the hills outside Kare. Indeed. In the dark it's hard to say how far back it goes, but someone has been here. There's a stack of pebbles against one wall, a little like the cairns in the tunnels of the Manticore. A stack of pebbles? I kind of feel like casting the house spell again, but we have so little stamina. I don't feel like having 5 unless we really have to. Take the pebbles? You gather the pebbles from inside the cave and put them into your pack. Oh, I think that's for a spell, actually. Now that I think about it. Pebbles. Pebbles. Well, use sand for quicksand. Stone dust for petrify. Yellow powder for haste. This is none of the above. Oh. The mag spell? No. Pop. Exploding pebbles. That's for the exploding pebbles spell. Sweet. How many do we have? Magical items? 3. Now it's been a while since I've even looked in here. I should remind myself about this spell. Requires 1 pebble. A potent little spell, but one which calls for great mental concentration. The spell must be cast on small pebbles, which will then explode when thrown. These explosions produce great force as well as a loud bang. Doesn't require any stamina, which is awesome. Let's rest in the cave. You make your way inside the cave and find a dark and safe corner. Settling down your pack on the rocks, you try to stretch out despite the wind. Okay. So hopefully we'll see this thing coming. This fire serpent. We gain stamina. Good. You stretch out and rest. You feel quite safe here, and you do not dream. Fishtail Rock, Day 3. During the past day, you found 3 new clues. When morning comes, you step back out into the empty plain. Sunlight falls into the cave mouth, picking out marks in the stone. Someone seems to have scratched a message into the rock inside the cave. It is only just legible and must be ancient. Let's read it. In the thin sunlight falling into the cave, you can make out the ancient scratched message with some difficulty. Stranger, I am waiting. Very long ago. Summon you. I'm guessing the dots are words we can't understand, or letters we can't understand. Very long ago. Summon you. Call my name to the skies, and I will... Something Adra. Adra. This isn't Pillars of Eternity. Fighting the Adra dragon. Shadrack the Hermit. The message on the cave wall suggests calling out a name, but what name should you call? Huh? Vic for First Noble, right? That's the werewolf guy back in Kare. Slang, who is the god of something or other. Not very, what do you call it? Not very pleasant. Shadrack, a hermit. Jan. Jan is that little pixie thing that was following us in episode 1 for a while. He was not that useful, and while he was around, we could not cast magic. That stunk. We got rid of him after a while. And Sansus and Lorag are the two of the nobles from Kare. Lorag is the scholar, the one you meet in the mansion. If you let him, he'll turn you into his apprentice pet forever. A lot of fun. And Sansus is that's the dead one you find in the. He's actually in a crypt cemetery. So anyway, it's Shadrack. Because no one else has Adra. As part of their name. You cry the name across the plains, and the echo of it seems to set off a distant avalanche. The ground begins to shake and rumble, and you stagger to your knees. The very earth is moving, as though it was splitting or merging back together. You reach down to steady yourself, only to find that grass is growing between your fingers. Whoa. You pick yourself unsteadily to your feet, feeling sick and unwell. Everything around you is the same, but everything is different. The rock has 2 spires, for one thing. The cave seems smaller and darker, and in a fire pit built into the scrub at its mouth, a fire is burning. From inside, you hear the gentle sound of singing. Only this area has changed. Oh, and there's those ripples we saw. We spotted those ripples... somewhere else. I think it was in here? And we figured it was some kind of noxious gas or something? Okay, so either we've affected the very nature of reality itself, or, well, Shadrack is. Oh, I'm not sure if that was there before. I'm noticing it now, though. Either we're affecting reality, or we've gone backwards or forwards in time... Or, yeah, travel to a different reality, something like that. There must be something about this clearing, too. I wonder how long it's going to stay like this. I'm not going to call it. Let's listen. Oh, I gained stamina. You pick yourself unsteadily to your feet, feeling sick and unwell. Do we gain stamina? Everything around you is the same, but everything is different. The rock has 2 spires, for one thing. The cave seems smaller and darker, and in a fire pit built into the scrub at its mouth, a fire is burning. From inside, you hear the gentle sound of singing. Oh, did I read all that before? Sorry, guys. You stop and listen. The singer is a man with a voice like gravel moving over ice. He sings in a language you do not recognize, but the melody seems to soothe your soul. Oh, I'm going to approach the fire. I like having my soul soothed, so that's a good thing. Okay, I've approached the fire, and now... call out for Shadrack. I don't want to draw my sword unless, you know, there's an obvious threat. Shadrack, you cry. I am here! The singing stops abruptly. There's a coughing and wheezing sound, and then an old man hobbles out from the cave, limping on a stick. This must be Shadrack himself, but you recognize the face as that of the tree spirit you met earlier. Ah, it's you, he declares, speaking thickly through his beard. I have been expecting you. He waves a hand around the landscape. Welcome back. Welcome back. Welcome back? Yeah. Just so. You have come a long, long way, my Annalander friend, he smiles. I know your mission, of course. I know all about you. And you know about me, I hope. My name is Shadrack. What do you know of me? You demand. I just want to ask him. I know where you come from, and I know where you're going, and that is all one can know about anyone, don't you think? He smiles. I know you journey here from Kari. Tell me, how fair is that city? It stands still. What does that mean? The same as always. You lie. Oh, I lied? Surely... was I supposed to say it stands still? I don't get it. So I lied. I didn't want to. The same as always, you lie. Surely if this man has knowledge, he must know that Kari is in great turmoil. He laughs. I watched an army of marsh goblins scale the cliffs, armed with swords and axes, he says. There should be smoke rising at the horizon, but I see no such thing. He grabs a handful of dry grass from the ground and tosses it into the fire pit, where it blazes for a moment into flame. He appears to change topic. I must warn you that no one from Adeland has ever crossed the backlands alone and survived. What are the dangers? This land is cursed, Shadrack replies. The very rocks and earth here are lost. Things become unstuck, and you have now become unstuck yourself. Do not understand. Unstuck in time? He demonstrates with his fingers as he speaks, twisting them together. The old world and the ancient world have grown together like thorny bushes. To journey through one is to journey through the other. The ancient world? You ask, looking about yourself as the fields of grass... at the field of grass that have appeared to replace the desert. Ishtara, the place that was. My home. Shadrack bows his head. You are most welcome. Unexpectedly, Shadrack stumbles. He smiles at you weakly. I do want to ask about food, but I want to be compassionate. Are you unwell? You ask. This whole land is unwell, he replies. I will not be able to stay for very long, he gasps suddenly. Please, ask me what you need to know, and then leave. Do you have any food? You ask, thinking practically. Shadrack shakes his head. I am too holy to eat, but if you can reach Kariyama, north of the river, you may be able to eat well there. If it still exists in your time. Most likely it does not. Okay, right, so I'm not in my time, that makes sense. Is this the ancient lands, then? Yeah. The place that was. So where in the place that was, which is his home, and... well, here it is. I wonder what made it turn from a lush grassland into a desert. If it still exists in your time, most likely it does not. As far as Kariyama. Well, I need food. Shadrack is shivering slightly now. His face is pale beneath the ruddy beard. Do you play Swindlestones? I'm not going to ask that. How did this curse come to be? I do want to ask that as well, but... The land was carved by the Archmage to be forgotten, and so it has, and so it will be. Not long now, and then all you see will be gone. Only timeless desolation will remain. Huh. But why? You demand. Because of you, Shadrack replies sharply. The Archmage punished this whole land to make a trap to kill you before you could kill him. He is a dangerous enemy. He is quite desperate. I understand he has sent seven serpents. You reply, to kill me. The hermit nods most seriously. The serpents are most terrible. Everything's most. He answers, I have often seen them, but they are no mere snakes. Do you know of their legend? Tell me. Shadrack nods, then coughs sharply. It is said that thousands of years from now, a few years ago for you, perhaps, the Archmage of Mampang fought and slew a mighty hydra, which dwelt in the caves of High Zaman. So formidable a foe was this creature that the Archmage took its seven heads back to Mampang, where he used his dark arts to resurrect them as seven-winged serpents. They became his personal messengers, his assassins, his force in dark places. So they are undead creatures? Not exactly, he replies. Silver will not harm them, if that's what you're thinking. Damn it. Rather, each serpent has a spirit to sustain it that grants a great power, but also a powerful weakness. Discover these weaknesses, and you may be able to defeat the serpents. Shadrack coughs and shivers. Friend, he murmurs, I wish I did not have to go, but I must, if I am to close the circle. He gets his stick and pushes himself up to his feet. Be gone, old man. Where are you going? I go to rest, he says. He sighs happily. I will plant my feet into the earth, and lift my arms as branches, and drink in the sunshine for as long as there is water in the soil. Time to leave. Like leaves? He raises his arms to demonstrate, laughs, almost teeters over, catches himself with his stick, and begins to cough violently. There it is! Not much time. But I have much to ask you. Shadrack nods. We will meet again. We have already met, I think. He waves a hand at his cave. I have left one more thing for you, in there. Travel well. Remember, when you walk through the fields of Ishtar, you are safe from the serpents. But if you do not return to your own time, you will never defeat them. How can I travel between these lands? Look to the beacons, he answers cryptically. If any have survived into your time, they will hold a little of our ancient light still. There is one to the north of here, at least, by the river. Go there. That tower? Reaching over, he places his hands on either side of your head, and you feel a great lightness entering your body. That done, he turns and stamps away across the grass. Follow him? You get up to race after him, but a moment later he has disappeared, lost in the haze that hangs above the grasslands. You remember what he said. The land is cursed, unstuck. It seemed he used his power to bring you together, but now you have once more drifted apart. You are left alone by the cave mouth once more. Let's look inside the cave. You look into the cave again, and this time find a strange horn hanging. Ooh! I have full stamina. Whoa. When did that happen? Find a strange horn hanging from a hook on the wall. It is ornately carved from strange twisting shell. From a strange twisting shell with a hide of leather. It is a gale horn, one of very few in existence. You lift it down with great care. Now, if I blow the horn, gale horn, oh, we're going to summon a storm. There's a spell that I can cast with it, though. I think. We're finding, yeah, Gust of Wind, the Huff spell, H-U-F. I'm not going to blow it. Should I blow it? I'm gonna blow it. You place the horn to your lips and blow a note. It is clean and mellow pitched, and someone needs to proofread, and makes the air stir with echoes. You silently thank the hermit for his gift. You make your way back to the old road that runs past the rock. To the north you catch a glimpse of the tower Shadrack mentioned that seems now to be covered in green ivy. West, you notice a young tree that surely wasn't there before. Your clues have been updated. Yeah, baby! The tree wasn't there. Oh, the whirlpool. Soaring earlier time. So let's check out our items. Our magical items. Galehorn. I am so glad I have full stamina, guys. You have no idea. Let's go to this tree first, I guess. I'm really curious about what goes on with the whirlpool as well. You head out across the prairie. The air moves a little, still icy, but fresh. You swat at pestering flies and midges. The dead tree you saw here earlier is now a young, strong sapling. In its shadow, a woman sits cross-legged with eyes closed. Look at the woman. We can look at things or leaves. Let's look at the woman. You watch the woman for a moment. She is breathing in and out slowly and murmuring under her breath. Perhaps she is praying? Around her neck, she wears what looks like a giant's tooth on a leather string. Oh, for the giant summon giant spell. Yob, I think. Yeah. A fleet of long, thin birds swoop and career overhead, snatching flies from the steamy air. I think I hear them. I'm gonna steal the tooth. Do I still have one? Check my magical items. I have one. I wouldn't steal one anyway. Look at the tree. The tree is relatively young, fresh and strong, though it has only been only planted a few minutes before. It is hard to believe this is the same tree that you saw before, so tall and so very dead, but the position is the same. Look around. You ignore the woman for a moment and look around the plain. South and west, the great fault line of the cliff shields out the sky, and at its top it seems as dark as night. North, the grass stretches away towards a distant flashing line that seems to cut across the sand. South and west. North. A distant flashing line. This flashing line? So we're safe here from the serpent. But, I mean, if we can even go this way, we might be going back in time. Or forward in time, rather. Although we can visit that. Maybe. If the game lets us go that way. Right now, well, we're limited to, you know, where we can go on the map, of course. Greetings! Do not fight me. I have full stamina. You approach the meditating woman and cough quietly. Greetings. The woman opens one eye, then shakes her head sadly. You're meant to be over there, she says, pointing a little way to the east. Where I came from? What do you mean? She shakes her head, opening her other eye. No matter. They tell me I will get better at divination with practice. She offers her hand. Oh, I'm gonna push her aside. Check her hand. And she laughs. How very formal. Well, you offered your hand. Well met, stranger. My name is Althera. Welcome to Ishtara, the land of peace and plenty. We can call it... Police! Shadrack called this place Ishtara as well. You remark, of course, such it is, she smiles. But I see from your bearing you truly are a stranger here. Ishtara is the ancient world, from the Zanzunu peaks in the east to the Cloud Cap Mountains north and down to the South Sea. I I am from Annaland, you explain. It seems from her expression that the name means nothing to her. You must have traveled far, she replies. She nods politely. Will you sit with me a while? Yeah. The only aid I really need is some food, but I'll sit with her. You sit down on the long grass opposite her. She smiles at you. I need to practice my third eye, she says, tapping what appears to be a small gem stuck to her forehead. Perhaps we could play? And reaching into her pocket, she produces a handful of small stones. Oh, boy. One game. One game. I do dislike the dice game, but one game. She looks amused. Swindlestones? My teachers used that name before, but that is not what we call them. They are mind stones. I try to read your thoughts as you read mine. Will you play? What is the stake? You ask. She laughs. Perhaps if you win, I will give you the dice. How's that? I am no telepath, you say. Nor me, but I am learning. Will you help me practice? Fine. Let's play. I'll play, you declare. Athera smiles. Thank you. You will find me a serviceable opponent, I hope. Athera counts out 4 dice each and waves at you to bid. Alright, so to remind, which each has a set of 4-sided dice, which we roll and hide. We bid on the amount of times a face value has been rolled across their own dice and the opponent's dice combined. Bids get higher and higher each turn. When one player believes their opponent's bid is too high, they can call to challenge the bid. The dice are revealed, and whoever loses challenges a die. Losing your last die forfeits the game. So, the amount of times, so we're not adding up. So I've got 2. Already. But I don't... Well... I can't move it? Wait. So wait. So moving these with the arrow keys. I don't think I did this before. So I'm gonna bet that she rolled 1, 3, because I have 2. Carrions love to pretend they're a breed apart. Reveal the dice. The round is mine. Nice. So instead of me getting her die, she loses a die. Your mind is very confusing. I should be able to see clearly into it, but I can't. I'll take that as a compliment. I will bid 3 4s. Wait. The game would be rather easy if you could. I will try to see. There's nothing easy about the sight. 3 4s, the round is yours. Cool. She got 2 left. You roll your dice and consider your opening bid. I will start with... I think I'm better at this than I used to be. So I've got two twos. I'm gonna bid three twos. I found a strange tower near here. The beacon. Oh, Rins are out. That's right, she only has two left. I like the sound of the clinking die. You have come through Kari. So what we call if we can call to challenge the bid. What is she bidding? One. Which might be right if she doesn't have one, then it's correct. But if she does, it's incorrect. Would she even bid one if she didn't have one? So let's call. Two fours. Oh, no, I screwed that up. I don't know what I'm doing after all. She bid that there was just one. Which she's right, because I had one. Never mind. We're evenly matched now, I think. I'm gonna bid two ones. Hope she has a one. Or should I bid one one? Let's bid one one. Okay, here's a bid. Try this. She's thinking that there's two twos. Which there might be if she has two of them. Try this. Two threes. I am seeing only one three. We're almost done. Hopefully I don't lose any gold for this. You have lots of questions. Two twos. I cannot answer all your questions. I am only young. Nope. That's the game, Althera says. You lose. Althera laughs with pleasure. Your mind is so open and easy to read, she exclaims without tact. Please, will you play again? I thought you said you couldn't read my mind. No more. You reply, shaking your head. You have defeated me. She nods sympathetically. Gathering up the dice, she drops them into your palm. Here, take these. She declares, you will have better use of them than I. I foresee as much. Okay, she should give me the dice anyway. I will take them. You drop the dice into your pack without another word. She nods and gets to her feet. I must be going, she says. Travel well. Come and visit me if you will. She waves in the direction of the cliff you came down when you entered the backlands. But quite why is not clear. Obviously that's where I go to visit her, isn't it? Then she hurries away. You turn your attention back to the landscape. Wow. Okay, so towards the cliff, it's along the road, the rock where he came from. Oh, notice the whirlwind is not an option now. Maybe if you go back to the rock, it is. The plane. gonna go back this way, see if we can go back to the whirlwind, and then north to the tower. You walk on across the grassland. Rocky outcrops break the ground here and there, and as the trail rises, you are soon walking on bare stone. The rising winds tug at your hair and cloak. Once again you see the distinctive fishtail rock sticking up from the earth, but there is no sign of Shadrack the Hermit. The fire outside the cave has burned down to black embers. You try calling out for Shadrack once more, but nothing happens. Wherever he is, whenever he is, it seems he has moved on. You stride on. You have been wandering the backlands for 3 days already, and you still have not crossed the ridge. No kidding. I'll decay the whirlpool. You make your way over the grass-covered rocks and boulders, following the trail where you can and scrambling the rest of the way. The sun continues to climb the steep sky. The dusty plains have been transformed to fields, though the grass here is littered with rocks that have tumbled down from the mountain range to the east. Nestled between two rocks is the same whirlpool you saw earlier. It seems to have been unaffected by the change in the landscape, although perhaps it is slightly smaller now. As you consider the whirlpool, a creature in an all-covering hood lopes into view. It is carrying something tightly in one hand, though you cannot make out what. "Greetings," you declare. The creature leaps in alarm, arms going wide, and drops whatever it was holding. A moment later, the whirlpool has sucked it away. The creature looks about in confusion. Point out the whirlpool. This seems a little too physical. You point at the whirlpool, trying to explain with gestures what it is, but the creature shakes its head, clearly not following. At least it does not go any closer. Grumbling, the creature shambles away westwards, knocking into you as it goes. Knocking into me? You could pickpocket me? Westwards. I just want to look. I'm thinking about my things, so... A set of dice. Curious four-sided dice. Here's the oil we got. A glob of Monarch oil goo from the queen lynch bug that you were told would harm the water serpent. Tinderbox. Follow the creature. I have no other choice. You follow the creature along the road, but you have only got a short way when it seems to vanish from your sight into the mists. You step back to the whirlpool to decide where to go next. Cast a spell. Gonna cast How again. I have the stamina this time. I'm hoping it's gonna give me an answer about the whirlpool and not just general. You craft the spell and a steady voice begins to speak to you. Once again it tells you that the whirlwind is a rare thing, a place with only one direction. It can be entered but it cannot be exited and is best avoided. Then the voice fades. Alright, I'm gonna move on. You continue on your journey. Which way? Let's go to the tower. The Tower of Doom. You set off across the prairie. The sun has reached its highest point now. Out of the shade, the air is baking hot. You are back at the stone tower once again. The tower seems mostly unchanged from before, except it is now overgrown with thick black gripweed. More impressively, the fissure behind it has transformed into a roaring river. Look at the river. You pause for a while, watching the river rushing past. The sound is calming, even though it is on the far side that the plains continue, and somehow you must cross. Tug the gripweed. You give the gripweed a sharp tug. The plant is tough as rope and seems to be firmly anchored into the stone of the tower. Maybe I don't have to cast my big spell. Let's move on. Climb up. The weed seems to grow all the way to the top. Alright. Nice. Quickly, you grab the grab weed, and scramble up the outside of the tower. The roots of the thick plant offer plenty of footholds, and ascent is easy enough. Soon you are hauling yourself over the battlements onto the top of the tower. Cool. It's an ancient Dwemer device. You stand atop the tower. The wind across the grassland throws your hair into your eyes, and the ground seems like an endless green sea far below. But the top is not empty. Indeed, there is barely room to stand. Most of the floor space is taken up by a large brass contraption that has been built into the middle of the roof. First, let's look at the view. From here, you can see all the way from the low mountains in the east to the cliff face that curves around the south and west, and the rushing river that splits the land to north. Towards the mountains. Looking away into the mountains, they rise suddenly and steeply, blocking the view beyond. Dark winged shapes circle their highest peaks. More nighthawks, perhaps? Or worse. But their slopes are partially wooded with grass around the double spike of Fishtail Rock. Look at the cliff. You look back at the cliff face from which you came. For a moment you seem to see a line of steps leading down the slope past a dark smudge. It is the cave mouth you saw earlier. Oh, cool. Can we climb those steps and then visit her? Huh? When it's not eroded away. So if they use Featherfall to get down or stuff like that. For a moment, this mountains to the east seems to spring into thick woodland as though a dusty cloud had lifted, revealing a forest below. Then the moment passes once more. Look at the plains. The plains around the rock are green and pleasant, but that greenery ends abruptly in dust on all sides. The effect is like a square of moonlight on a dark floor, or a lonely rock rising from the surface of a stagnant lake. You turn your attention away from the view. Birds wheel and tumble in the air a short distance away. Look at the contraption on the tower. The tower was clearly built to house the brass contraption in the center of the turret. You look it over with curious interest. A large brass cylinder, it is set into a bearing in the center of the tower, and protrudes a short way over the battlement. It is rather like one of the chief mage's telescopes. But why would anyone set such a complex device out here in the wastes? Look through it. You crouch to look through the cylinder, but find you cannot. It has no eyepiece. The near end disappears unbroken into the brass mounting of the device. The bearing underneath the cylinder looks as though it might allow the contraption to move. Furthermore, set in the central dome is an impressive-looking blue crystal. No eyepiece. Look at the blue crystal. It is not a gem you recognize. It pulses with a small interior glow, as though something lived inside. Take the crystal? I gain stamina. You touch the crystal, but as your fingers brush the glass, something happens, and you feel yourself whipped up into the air as though catapulted. For a dizzy moment, you seem to stare down at the entire land of Badubak. Then a moment later, you are back on your feet, head reeling, but feeling curiously powerful. Okay. I'm not going to touch it again. Looks like it gives you some points. Could possibly even top off your stamina. I really can't tell because I was only missing one point. So just in case it has charges or a limited amount of uses, I'm going to step back and not touch it. You step back, fearful but curious. I am not fearful. The blue crystal on the contraption is flashing brilliantly, and then suddenly the cylinder ignites with a thick beam of syrupy light. Syrupy light? Light can be many things, but syrupy? The beam floods across the landscape, cutting through the mists and warping into view like a heat haze. Oh, there's another one. I see. The land in the light of the beam has changed. It seems the magic you witnessed earlier is happening again. Back. The view is now partially lit with the beam from the tower, and a different land appears in its light. Birds fly. Gentle wind stirs pollen in a haze. Look at the beam. Careful not to touch the light, you examine the beam. It seems to come into focus a few cubits from the edge of the tower, and then floods outwards, changing the very color of the air as it goes. On the ground you see dusty sand beneath its light, with grass growing on either side. This must be the beacon that Shadrack mentioned. That's what I figured. Adjust the beam? Oh. Look at that. Ah. Oh. Can I go more this way? I can. It's really awkward. Huh. Really, it goes the opposite way I want it to. Seriously. Because I'm dragging left. Okay. Dragging down. Yeah, see that whole forest is not there in current times. Nor is that. That's her. That's where she lives, isn't it? Is that what I'm looking at? And this is a river. I want to go down. God. It's so touchy. It doesn't move the way I want it to. Definitely not. Yep, there's the other telescope. For lack of a better term. And we've got, like, farmland here. And like a farmhouse. Instead of these little dilapidated looking structures. Well, I think they're dilapidated. We've got a little something here. It's like not there at all. Or it's, I don't know, some kind of crater. So I think I want to explore as much of the lush area as possible so the fire serpent doesn't attack me. Which, by speaking of which, there's the water serpent. So we can't really see past these. It looks lush no matter what on the other side, doesn't it? You adjust the beam around its track, sweeping light over the land below. With the beacon blazing away, you swing yourself over the battlement once more. After an uncertain moment, you find the gripweed and clamber swiftly down. Cool. You scramble down the tower and drop the last few feet to ground level. So we can't get inside this tower? Kind of looks like an entrance there, doesn't it? You head back southwards, checking... Ah, oh, he bumped it. When he bumped into me, I knew it. I don't remember all my items, guys. So I didn't even notice. Checking through your pack, you suddenly stop short. Something, the cloth skull cap is missing. Think back. You think back, racking your brains. Then you remember the creature by the whirlpool who knocked into you as you walked away. A pickpocket. Revenge will be mine. Lifting your voice to Kurga, you vow revenge should you ever encounter the hooded creature again. Kurga's not into that. But nothing changes as a result of your cursing. You will have to find the creature should you wish to recover the skull cap. Oh, the beam is facing that way then. This just goes back. Let's head this way, I guess. Trying to come to a point where there's a decision, guys. I know it's been a long episode. You return to the road. The afternoon is starting to draw on. Okay. Okay, so we've been... We're done with the tree. The road east... I could possibly go this way. I've been to the tower already. So, it looks like this is unaffected by the... It looks like this is unaffected. But there might possibly be things there still. Look at that, it's like... It keeps changing. But there might be new things here. Possibly. So, yeah, my choice for next episode, guys. The road east, across the plain, or the road north. These two are obviously for anything new that might be discovered. This is ultimately going ahead, because we've been over this way. Ultimately going ahead this way, I'm hoping. So, yeah. Back to the trees, not an option for voting. Neither is towards the tower. Unless you guys want to addendum me change the beam to one of these areas. Which I suppose wouldn't be hard to do. I might actually do that in any case, just to change the beam. I don't know if that changes what's, you know, what, like, the land. It looks like it's the same no matter what. It just happens to be pointing this way. So yeah, our options. Road east, cross the plain, road north. Choose one of those three, guys. Thanks so much for watching. See you in the next episode. And endure. In enduring, grow strong.